Good afternoon, everyone. It is a pleasure to be here with you today as we continue to reflect on how we collectively can contribute to the concrete implementation of the vision of the Knowledge Equity Network. I join you from DePaul University, a private institution in the United States, whose ethos and mission of enhanced access to quality education for all, particularly for disenfranchised and underrepresented populations, needs to come to grips daily with the reality of escalating costs and substantial reliance on student fees. I say this at the outset as what I'm going to offer to our common reflection today is unavoidably colored by the context in which I operate and by its present constraints. Constraints that may in some cases appear quintessentially American and may need a bit of translation and adjustments to other realities, to your own realities. As we work towards the ultimate goal of an open knowledge ecosystem, I feel strongly that our collective responsibility is to start implementing realistic steps towards achieving universal, collaborative, inclusive, and sustainable higher education. We cannot just sit and wait for the perfect tomorrow. We need instead to strive for the good today. And this, for me personally, means dealing with a system in which free or affordable higher education is not a visible reality at all. This is the ultimate infrastructure obstacle, but changing the way in which higher education is financed in the United States requires a long and difficult political battle. That is the perfect tomorrow. But what can I do today, given the current circumstances, while I continue to fight for the perfect tomorrow? I feel strongly that through concrete, practical attempts at implementing aspects of a more open system of global higher education, we actually learn exactly where the infrastructure-related barriers are that we can try to conquer today. As a result, today, I feel that we can adopt two different but complementary approaches. On one hand, we can identify and fight the infrastructural battle to change things and remove obstacles. On the other, we can find clever ways to operate within existing infrastructures, transcending, where possible, their limitations. And I'm going to give two concrete examples. The first one is the virtual exchange COIL movement. If you're not familiar with the collaborative online international learning model, in a nutshell, it consists of learning experiences designed collaboratively by usually two academics in two different parts of the world that engage students in mixed groups in collaborative projects with clearly defined learning outcomes and very often with clearly identified deliverables, where sustained communication and collaboration takes place among students. This model transcends the infrastructural difficulties of credit transfer, money exchange, privileged access to global network of institutions, access to sophisticated technologies, relying instead on basic willingness of individual academics to open their classroom to other realities around the world. In trying to implement this model, one learns quickly where several other obstacles lie. One simple poignant example: all of our institutions are more and more relying on learning management systems. Most of these are, or become after implementation, closed proprietary ecosystems for many reasons: security, the need for data protection, desire for data collection on our students, and so on. the simple action of having two groups in two different institutions, in two different countries, using two different LMSs, trying to collaborate, surfaces a whole series of impediments. What to do? Yes, we can fight the noble fight and try to advocate and work for a more flexible, shareable structure of learning management system. I'll say a word about this in a second. But what many of our practitioners of virtual exchange COIL do is they find or create third spaces outside of either LMSs in which students collaborate, transcending again this obstacle. In the meantime, there is hope for the solutions of interoperability of LMSs that is emerging as the various LMS providers have heard the call for easier collaboration. And we have experimented now a couple of times with the possibility of connecting two different LMSs in a much simpler and more nimble and flexible way. So again, this duality, right? The fight for infrastructural improvement towards open access and more collaborative approaches to higher education. On the other hand, though, trying to find a way to overcome the current situation. While most of the first implementations of virtual exchange COIL projects were between institutions in the global north working with institutions in the global south, with English almost always as lingua franca, now the movement is witnessing an explosion of global south to global south collaborations, in many of which Spanish is the lingua franca. So this first example gives you a view of a movement that is open, not universal yet, admittedly, but definitely collaborative and inclusive. The second example I want to use is the global conversations. These are cycles of 90 minutes synchronous conversations held on Zoom, led by teams of academics from different institutions around the world, open and free for students from any institution around the world. Each conversation engages students on a topic of global relevance, from global health issues to urban design to some of the sustainable development goals and many more. The DePaul Global Engagement Team started offering this platform in the spring of 2020 as a partial response to the pandemic. And now this initiative has taken a life of its own. The last cycle took place in October 2022 with 16 different conversations attended by 656 students from 70 different institutions from 28 different countries. Facilitated by 47 academics from 17 different institutions from 13 different countries. I'm not listing these figures just to boast, but to make the point that sometimes a simple, slightly unorthodox idea that again transcends the strictures of existing infrastructures resonates with the appetite of many and can move the needle. What infrastructure obstacle did we encounter? Honestly, just a very American perspective that these efforts use up a significant amount of staff time, but in the end generate no revenue. But sometimes you need to push the envelope a bit to achieve broader goals. These conversations are completely open, have the potential to be universal. They're certainly inclusive. And their sustainability depends on the willingness of many partners in the world. I'm going to stop now with a couple of very direct questions and provocations for all of you that hopefully will stimulate the conversation for this hour. What can you, in your position, whether you're a faculty member, an academic, or a staff person, involved in supporting the academic enterprise do today? What infrastructural obstacles are you encountering? And what can you do on one hand to try to change things And at the same time, what can you do to overcome these obstacles today, right now? In what conversations and decision-making processes at your local level, at your institutional level, maybe for some of you at the national and global level, are you involved today where you can make a difference in changing the infrastructures or in transcending the current limitations? I'm looking forward to your thoughts and ideas. And for now, I thank you very much for your attention and willingness to engage with this process.